Nudged presents Spacejackers 2, The Lost Sword by Huw Powell, narrated by Mike Grady.
Prologue. Deep space. There's a storm brewing. Baden Scott stood on the bridge of his salvage trawler, the Rough Diamond 3, clutching a flask of coffee and staring through the window at the distant stars. His crew had been cruising deep space for almost a week in search of scrap. But the only thing they had recovered beyond the seven solar systems was a stray satellite. If they didn't find something valuable soon, Baden would be forced to sell his holiday home on Rios. "You're right. The scanners are picking up activity in the asteroid field ahead," said Kiki, the pilot. "I'll give it a wide berth." Baden smiled and rubbed his stubbly chin. "I love a good space storm. Nothing can stop those big old rocks once they start moving. If anything gets in their way, they crush it and sweep it aside, no questions asked." "That sounds like the Interstellar Navy," said Kiki, pulling on the controls. "You're not wrong," Baden laughed, and swigged his coffee. "Mind you, I would rather take my chances with those asteroids. At least they play fair." The Rough Diamond 3 changed course and headed further into deep space, where few ships dared to go. There wasn't much to salvage that far out, but at least no one would try to spacejack their new trawler. "Hey, Baden."
"Yeah?"
"I'm picking up something on the long-range scanner."
Kiki adjusted her display. "There's a cluster of shapes heading towards the seventh solar system."
"More asteroids?"
"I don't think so. They're in battle formation."
"Battle formation?" choked out Baden. "Are you sure?"
"Yeah. Like a fleet of warships. But what would the Interstellar Navy be doing out here?"
"There's only one reason why that many ships would be sneaking through deep space." Baden drained his coffee and popped a wad of chewing gum into his mouth. "War."
Kiki looked horrified.
"What war?"
"You mean those ships are going to attack an independent colony?"
"Why stop at one?" said Baden, chewing grimly. "There's enough laser power in that fleet to take out the entire seventh solar system. I suggest we get out of here before we're spotted."
"Where do you want to go?"
"Set course for the sixth solar system."
Baden watched the shapes on the long-range scanner. "We can find work there while the storm blows over." Chapter 1. The Trading Station. The ISS Timidus loomed over the trading station like a hunched metal spectre. It was one of nine naval gunships patrolling the fifth solar system, with orders to protect the crystal trade routes from space pirates. Gunships were smaller than warships, and they carried less crew, but they were faster and able to bear heavy laser cannon. In comparison, the trading station resembled a large copper doughnut suspended in space. Its tarnished hull contained rows of porthole windows which glowed with warm amber light. The traders were used to raids, only this time the ISS Timidus wasn't searching for stolen ship parts or illegal weapons, but something far more dangerous. Inside, naval troops in midnight blue uniforms herded traders and customers to the central atrium, where they gathered below a spiral escalator. A senior officer paced the floor, his polished gravity boots clipping the metal grating. He surveyed the crowd with narrow, bloodshot eyes, but most of their faces were concealed under traditional wide-brimmed hats.
"What's the point of these ridiculous things in space?" he asked, snatching one from a female trader and throwing it across the atrium. "I'm going to ask you, Richards, one more time. Have any of you seen a cargo hauler named the Dark Horse?"
No one spoke.
"Admiral Ventard has reason to believe that this pirate ship was responsible for the disappearance of the ISS Colossus superdestroyer 3 months ago," said the officer. "He's particularly keen to talk with the crew and their teenage captain, Jake Cutler."
One of the male traders snorted, causing the officer to turn sharply.
"Is there something funny about a child spacejacker?"
The trader was a large man with pale skin and huge arms. He raised his head and stared back with wolf-like eyes.
"Well?" demanded the officer.
"My friend doesn't speak much," said a bronze-skinned man next to him, "but I'm sure he didn't mean any offence."
The officer glared at the pair of them, like an impatient teacher with two disruptive pupils.
"There's a reward for the boy," he said, stepping back to address the wider crowd. "A crate of crystals for his capture. He can be identified by his brown hair, purple eyes, and gold pendant."
"What about his cutlass?" interrupted a younger trader.
"What about it?"
snapped the officer, rounding on the boy and swiping the hat from his head. "It's very sharp," said the trader, producing a cutlass from inside his coat. The officer took one look at the boy's bright purple eyes and raised his arms.
"Jake Cutler?"
"Captain Cutler, according to you." Jake prodded the officer in the stomach. "Tell your troops to drop their weapons before I gut you with my blade." Jake was no ordinary teenager. He was a space pirate and the ruler of a secret planet, Altus. It hadn't always been this way. Until a few months ago, Jake had lived with cyber monks on Remota, a secluded planet in the seventh solar system. He had grown up, not knowing who he was or where he was from. His only clue had been a gold pendant containing three crystals, a diamond, a ruby, and an emerald. When the monastery was attacked by naval troops disguised as space pirates, Jake had escaped Remota aboard an old cargo hauler called the Dark Horse, which turned out to be a pirate ship belonging to the Space Dogs. With their help, Jake had discovered Altus hiding inside the Tego Nebula dust cloud. But not before they had defeated Admiral Nex and his super-destroyer, the ISS Colossus.
"Now, hold on," said the officer.
The naval troops saw what was happening and turned their plasma rifles on Jake, who responded by nudging his sword a little harder. He had never gutted anyone in his life, but the troops didn't know that. As far as they were concerned, he had single-handedly destroyed the ISS Colossus, making him more dangerous than other famous pirates, such as James Hawker or Scarabus Shark. Jake had earned himself the nickname Kid Cutler.
"You heard him?"
said the officer, his voice now several pitches higher.
"Drop your weapons. That's an order."
The troops lowered their plasma rifles and placed them on the floor. Three space pirates shared their disguises and stepped from the crowd to collect the guns, including the large pale man, Kodan, his bronze-skinned friend, Farid, and a muscular shipmate with thick dreadlocks, Wurak. The crowd dispersed around them as traders and customers abandoned the station before more troops arrived.
"Captain Cutler,"
said Farid, who was the first mate aboard the Dark Horse.
"Why not?"
laughed Jake. "You have to admit, there's a certain ring to it." Farid raised an eyebrow.
"Wait until the real captain finds out that you're after her job."
"It's okay," said Jake. "I'm not in a hurry to lead anyone." After removing his uncle Kia from power, Jake had taken his rightful place as the ruler of Altus, only to discover that he wasn't ready to lead. His home planet had not felt complete without his missing father, Andras Cutler. When the space dogs were forced to leave in a hurry, Jake had decided to go with them and continue his search for his father. It had not been easy to abandon his people, but how else would he find the true ruler of Altus?
"What do you want with us, space jacker?"
asked the naval officer.
"With you? Nothing," said Jake. "We just need to borrow your gunship for a while."
Kodan grinned. He was the master at arms, responsible for keeping peace aboard the Dark Horse, despite being unable to speak a word. Farid produced a communicator from his pocket.
"Ahoy, Calidus. We've secured our guests. How are you and Capio getting on?"
Calidus Stone was an ex-naval officer turned fortune seeker.
He had spent years searching for Altus with his clumsy companion, Capio Craven. Calidus had helped Jake to escape from Remota and find his home planet.
"Ahoy, Farid," said Calidus. "The crew didn't put up much of a fight. We're on the bridge now, and I'm accessing their ship's computer. It shouldn't take long. Not much has changed since I was in the Interstellar Navy."
"You're aboard our ship?" exclaimed the officer.
"Yes," said Jake. "We need to access the main naval server to find out what you lot know about us, so we can keep one step ahead of you. And I want information about a ship that was destroyed 11 years ago." The communicator crackled.
"That's interesting," muttered Calidus.
"What is?"
asked Farid.
"An old naval buddy of mine has retired."
"Fascinating," said Farid impatiently.
"Now hurry up and find something useful."
"Why don't we take their ship?"
asked Jake. "Isn't that what spacejackers are supposed to do?"
"Yeah, right," said Farid. "I can just imagine turning up at the next service port in a naval gunship. It's not exactly discreet, is it?"
"We don't need another ship," stuttered Warak. "Not now we have new registration plates and coats of paint."
"Ah," said Calidus.
"What's up?" asked Farid.
"This isn't the only naval vessel in the area. A warship is approaching and it's hailing the gunship."
"Ah," echoed Farid.
A cold panic spread through Jake's body. It was bad enough to encounter a naval warship in open space, where they could at least make a run for it. But they were docked inside a trading station with the gunship crew as hostages.
"Get everyone back to the ship," instructed Calidus. "I'll delay them."
"Let's go,"
said Farid, backing towards the exit.
"Leaving so soon?" sneered the officer.
Jake flicked his cutlass with lightning speed and sliced open the officer's jacket. He watched the silver buttons spill onto the metal grating.
"Oops, sorry about that," he said.
Farid, Kodan, Warek and Jake hurried through a red arched walkway to the maintenance bay, where the rest of the crew were waiting. It was hard to run in gravity shoes, and the air was thick with incense cubes, which were used to disguise the stench of recycled oxygen. As they reached the bay entrance, three people stumbled out of another passage, holding midnight blue containers.
"Watch out," warned Farid.
Kodan and Warek instinctively raised the plasma rifles they had collected.
"Wait, don't shoot,"
said a voice from behind one of the crates.
"Maka?"
recognized Jake.
"Aye," said the shipmate, lowering his container. "The captain sent us to get some supplies from the gunship."
Maka Metalhead was a gnarly-looking shipmate with a face full of scars and piercings. Next to him stood Jake's two teenage friends, Keller and Nanu, their arms laden with naval supplies. Keller Anderson was a United Worlds citizen and a talented crystal healer. Jake had often wondered how someone could cure people with shiny stones, but whenever he asked her, Keller just shrugged her shoulders and told him that it was a gift. Apparently the crystals were only tools that helped to channel her healing powers, in the same way that a megaphone was used to amplify sound. Jake had first met Keller in Papa Don's illegal spaceport, where she had been held for ransom because her family owned a crystal mine in the 6th solar system. Her sister Jane had been on her way to pay the ransom when the Interstellar Navy had arrested her, leaving Keller at the mercy of the space mafia. Jake had helped to free Keller, who was now part of the Space Dog's crew and the ship's medic. Nanu was a lilac-skinned Novu alien from planet Tarn Centaur in a distant galaxy. His exploration ship had crashed into an asteroid, killing his parents and the crew. He'd been left alone, stranded for a whole year inside the shipwreck before Jake discovered him. What Nanu lacked in language skills, he made up for with his knowledge of advanced alien technology, which he had used to make a number of improvements to the Dark Horse. This included engine enhancements, stronger electronic shields, and more powerful laser cannon, all of which made the old cargo hauler much tougher
than it looked. Keller flicked aside her long black hair and opened a container full of food pouches. These naval munches look much nicer than that stuff in the trader canteen.
"And we disable gunship engine," said Nanu, his wide turquoise eyes sparkling with delight. "They not go anywhere fast."
"Good work," approved Farid. "But we need to hurry." In the maintenance bay, they were met by the chief engineer, Skargus, and his assistant, Manik.
"We can't leave yet," protested Skargus. "The ship is not ready."
"Sorry, we don't have any choice," said Farid. "There's a naval warship heading our way.
But we've not tested the new boosters. The rear shields need calibrating, and the intercom is faulty."
"And the paint is still wet," added Manik, holding up her artificial arm, which was covered in red flecks.
"Will she fly?" asked Farid. "Aye," said Skargus, "but that's all I need to know."
Farid headed straight for a cargo hauler with a plump red hull.
"Let's get the old girl into the stars." "I heard that," croaked a silver-haired woman standing at the top of the loading ramp. "And you'd better be talking about the ship."
"Aye, Captain."
Granny Leatherhead was captain of the Dark Horse, which had served the space dogs for over 20 years. It had endured many adventures, and its battle scars were still visible beneath the coat of paint. Jake had grown fond of the old cargo hauler. It was like one of the crew, a comrade in arms. Thanks to Nanu, the ship now boasted 4 new booster exhausts and a multi-barreled laser cannon hidden inside its nose.
"Ain't she a beauty?" sighed Skargus.
"Aye, she'll do," said Farid, climbing the loading ramp.
Now you're talking about me," cackled Granny Leatherhead.
The captain was dressed in a faded black combat suit, which was covered in patches, straps, and buckles. It was traditional for pirate crews to have their own colours and customise their outfits. A crusty leather patch covered one of her eyes, while the other looked down her hooked nose at the naval supplies.
"I hope you picked up something a bit stronger than fruit juice this time," she said.
The maintenance bay doors crashed open, and Calidus entered, closely followed by Capio. Jake noticed that the tall fortune seeker was holding a data crystal.
"Start the engine," shouted Calidus, his long coat flapping behind him.
"What happened?" asked Farid from the top of the loading ramp.
"It's the naval warship," said Calidus. "I didn't know the latest security codes."
"How long before they're in range?" asked Granny Leatherhead.
2 minutes.
"Blast it!"
The captain turned to a blue-haired woman waiting in the cargo hold.
"Nichelle, fire up the engine. We're leaving in 1 minute."
"That's not all," said Calidus, as he reached the bottom of the ramp. "It's the ISS Magnificent. Admiral Vantard has tracked us down."
Chapter 2. The Divine Wind. Jake and the space dogs had been blamed for the disappearance of Admiral Algor Nex after he was sucked into a black hole along with his super destroyer, the ISS Colossus. It was now common knowledge that Admiral Nex had been searching for a teenage space pirate with purple eyes. The name Jake Cutler had spread throughout the galaxy as the boy who had defeated the most advanced warship in the Interstellar Navy. Now there was a new admiral in charge, Voratio Vantard, the most decorated officer in naval history. His handsome face and dashing smile often featured on the stellar net, with reports of daring feats and dangerous missions. His fine copper hair and bottle-green uniform were smart even for a naval officer, prompting his nickname Admiral Vantard. If anyone wanted to be credited with capturing the most dreaded space pirate of all time, it was him. The space dogs had been hunted by Admiral Vantard since leaving Altus, occasionally crossing laser cannon with his warship, the ISS Magnificent. If Nanu hadn't used his alien technology to strengthen the cargo hauler's shields, the entire crew would have been stardust by now.
but they could not survive on luck forever. It was only a matter of time before Admiral Vantard captured the Dark Horse and punished them for making the Interstellar Navy appear weak. What if they were tortured, and one of the crew revealed the secret location of Altus? Jake was starting to wonder if he had made the right decision to leave his home planet. He had put his people in danger to search for his missing father, and he didn't know where to start. If only he knew what Andras Cutler looked like, or why he had stayed away for so long. Jake had not considered what would happen once they found his father. What if he didn't want anything to do with Altus? More to the point, what if he didn't want anything to do with Jake? In the trading station, the Dark Horse rattled and clanked as the crew prepared for takeoff. Jake hurried to the guest quarters, where he shared a room with Calidus and Capio. He climbed into his bunk and listened to the sound of the loading ramp close beneath the ship. It wasn't the first time they had launched in a hurry, but he still experienced a rush of adrenaline as the engine roared to life.
"Get yourselves strapped in, quick, folks," instructed Granny Leatherhead over the faulty intercom, her voice sounding deep and stretched. "We're leaving as soon as the bay doors open."
Jake fastened his buckles and lay flat on his bunk, staring at the flashing amber lights on the ceiling. It had been good to stop running for a few days, but now it was time to flee the trading station. He wondered how much longer they could keep this up. Weeks? Months? Skargus had once told him that life as a space pirate was mostly hard work and hiding from the Interstellar Navy. It certainly seemed that way. Nichelle released the thrusters, which thundered like an explosion, refusing to end. Jake felt the Dark Horse surge towards the bay doors. His bunk vibrated as the ship gathered speed, bumping him against the bedstraps. The bay walls blurred past the porthole window, until suddenly, without warning, they were replaced by stars as the old cargo hauler hurled itself into space. "Hello, Big Black," whispered Jake, releasing his straps and floating free from his bunk, no longer held down by artificial gravity. He kicked off the nearest wall and propelled himself towards the window so he could see what was happening outside. Through the scratched glass, he caught sight of the naval warship, its long midnight blue hull cutting through the stars. The name ISS Magnificent was printed on the side in tall white letters, each one larger than the Dark Horse. Jake pushed himself away from the window and back to his bunk, where his homemade gravity shoes were stuck to the wall. He plucked them off the metal surface and slipped them onto his feet, allowing the magnetic soles to drag him to the floor.
"Where are you going?" asked Calidus.
"To the bridge," said Jake. "The captain might need our help." He climbed through the hatch door and hurried down the corridor, past the engine room, up the metal staircase and along the top deck to the front of the cargo hauler. As usual, Nichelle was piloting the ship, while Farid watched the scanners and Kodan stood silently by the door. Granny Leatherhead looked tired as she paced the floor.
"Captain, we're being hailed by the ISS Magnificent," said Farid. "Ignore them," croaked Granny Leatherhead. "They'll find out who we are soon enough, once they've spoken with the gunship crew. Nichelle, it's time to try out the new boosters."
"Aye, Captain." The pilot tightened her dark blue ponytail and punched several buttons on her control panel. Jake grabbed hold of the hatch and braced himself for acceleration.
"Wait," said Farid. "There's another ship in the way." "Who is it?" asked Granny Leatherhead, her single grey eye squinting at the main display. "It's an old space cutter called the Loose Cannon, registered to a fortune seeker named Carla Grit."
"Not another meddling mercenary," groaned Granny Leatherhead. "That's the fifth one since leaving Altus. If the reward for our capture goes up much higher, I'll be tempted to hand myself in." "Is her ship armed?"
"Aye. But it only has a single laser cannon," said Farid. "I'm more worried about the ISS Magnificent behind us, if our rear shields have not been calibrated." "So let's turn about and face them."
but our exhausts will be exposed to the loose cannon.
Calidus and Capio entered the bridge. What's going on? Asked the fortune seeker. Why have we stopped?
Kala grit.
Granny Leatherhead pointed a wrinkled finger at the main display. Is she a friend of yours?
Grit?
Calidus swept back his dark, wavy hair, revealing two metal studs fixed to the sides of his head.
I've only ever heard of her by reputation. Carla Grit would sell her own parents for a fistful of crystals.
Captain, the ISS Magnificent is still hailing us, said Farid.
I don't think the new registration plates have worked. They're preparing their laser cannon.
Blast it!
Cursed Granny Leatherhead, holding her forehead.
Michelle, get us out of here!
I can't, said the pilot. The loose cannon is matching our every move.
Then ram her out of the way!
No, said Jake, watching from the doorway. We'll rupture our hull.
Who asked you?
He's right, said Calidus. A collision is too risky, even with our strengthened shields.
Okay, fine, snapped the captain. Blow it a stardust.
If we do that, the naval warship will open fire for sure, said Farid.
So what in the name of Zerost can we do?
Granny Leatherhead scowled at Calidus.
This is all your fault.
Me?
Aye, you and your idiotic ideas. I can't believe you talked me into spacejacking a naval gunship. Was it worth it? Did its computer tell you anything useful?
No, but
I knew it, she barked. I must have been mad to let you lot join my crew.
Captain, urged Farid. Both ships are preparing to fire.
We should surrender, said Capio, before it's too late.
Ha! Shrieked Granny Leatherhead. How long have you been on this ship? It's not in a space dog's nature to give up without a fight. Michelle, turn the ship about to face the ISS Magnificent. We're going to blow a hole in its horrible hull before Ms. Grit tears open our rear.
Aye, Captain. Aren't you insane? Said Calidus. That's suicide. I know we defeated the ISS Colossus, but it was already damaged, and we were helped by a black hole. Capio's right. We have to surrender.
Stand down, Cali Dunce, warned Granny Leatherhead. I'm the captain of this ship, and I say we fight.
Surrender, insisted the fortune seeker, reaching for his pistol.
Fight,
she yelled, fetching her own gun.
The two of them stood, inches apart, weapons drawn and eyes fixed on each other.
Stop it, shouted Jake. Don't we have enough enemies?
Captain, interrupted Farid. There's a third ship.
Fine by me, she said, not taking her eye off Calidus. Let's see how many it takes to bring down the space dogs.
It's a pirate ship, Farid tapped feverishly on his display. A star frigate called the Divine Wind. It's heading straight for the ISS Magnificent. Granny Leatherhead almost dropped her pistol as she turned to look at the display screen. Jake caught sight of a bright yellow ship with a space pirate emblem painted on its hull. Only the crew had used crossed feathers instead of bones. There was also a blood-red letter K printed on the side and several pink laser cannon jutting out of its gun ports.
It can't be the Divine Wind, muttered Granny Leatherhead, her face whitening. Not after all these years.
The yellow star frigate opened fire, catching the ISS Magnificent by surprise and scorching its hull before it veered sharply and accelerated in the opposite direction. Jake could make out the words, "Kiss my cutlass," written on its rear. He watched the naval warship change course to pursue the pirate ship, its own laser cannon blazing. Granny Leatherhead turned her back on the screen.
Now's our chance, Nichelle. Head straight for Carla Grit. Kodan, prepare Nanu's latest invention in case she refuses to budge. It's time we left the fifth solar system.
Hi, Captain, said Nichelle, tugging at her controls.
Kodan nodded and marched over to a small panel beneath the main display, which he slid aside to reveal a secret compartment in the nose of the ship. Jake had watched Nanu working on the multi-barreled laser cannon, which they had nicknamed Old Lizzie after the captain. He knew that the crew were itching to try it out, especially Kodan, who now squeezed into the tight space. Granny Leatherhead glared at the space cutter.
Your move, nasty knickers!
The dark horse drew closer, gathering speed, but the loose cannon held its position. Jake spotted a hatch opening on its hull.
Captain, she's up to something.
A hose slithered out of the hole with a sprinkler attached to the end.
That's no laser cannon, said Farid.
What is it? Asked Jake.
That, my lad, is trouble, said Granny Leatherhead. Brace yourself for an acid shower.
But they're illegal, exclaimed Capio.
So is spacejacking, pointed out Calidus. Will the shields hold out? Let's not find out, said Granny Leatherhead. Avast, Nichelle! Pull back!
It's too late, cried the blue-haired pilot. Jake was shocked to see globules of green liquid spray from the sprinkler head, creating a web of acid in front of them. The dark horse ploughed straight through the toxic rain, which splattered across the front of the ship, burning holes in their shields and scarring the hull. At the same time, Carla Grit opened fire with her single laser cannon.
My lovely paint job, screeched Granny Leatherhead. What are you waiting for, Kodan? Kill that sneaky space witch!
Kodan pulled the trigger, and a string of laser bolts fired in rapid succession, like splintered lightning exploding from the nose of the ship. His huge arms shook violently as he tried to control the multi-barreled weapon. If Jake had thought the sawn-off laser cannon were loud, they were nothing compared to this booming beast. It used up so much power, the bridge lights dimmed and the computer displays flickered.
Missed, reported Farid.
Kodan grunted, took aim, and fired again, this time scattering laser bolts like flaming buckshot. Jake watched as several of them exploded on Carla Grit's shields.
That's it, said Granny Leatherhead. Keep shooting!
The Fortune Seeker knew that she was outgunned, and she changed her tactics. Her ship circled around the dark horse, targeting its exposed rear. Jake felt the hull shake as the cargo hauler received yet another battle scar.
Maka! Wurak! Roll out the stubbies! Ordered Granny Leatherhead through the intercom, which now made her voice sound high-pitched and squeaky. Nichelle! Turn us about! Don't let her get a clean shot at our exhausts!
Nichelle turned the dark horse while hidden gun ports scraped open on the side of the hull to reveal a row of sawn-off laser cannon.
Now, boys, croaked Granny Leatherhead. Fire!
Maka and Wurak unleashed their cannon, spitting out laser bolts and forcing Carla Grit to abandon her attack. As her ship peeled away, Nichelle swung the nose of the dark horse around and Kodan pumped out a third stream of laser bolts, penetrating the space cutter's shields and rupturing its hull.
Direct hit, cheered Farid. Her systems are down. Finish her off. Don't waste the lasers, said Granny Leatherhead. Let space have her.
Kodan ceased fire, leaving a ringing silence in the air. Jake watched the loose cannon on the computer display, damaged and adrift. He felt a sudden pity for the Fortune Seeker. What if that had been Calidus? But Granny Leatherhead showed no remorse.
Nichelle, get us out of here before that naval warship returns.
Aye, Captain.
Nichelle accelerated away from the trading station, putting as many stars as possible between the Dark Horse and the ISS Magnificent.
Captain?
Yes, Jake.
Who owns the Divine Wind?
Chapter 3 Wild Joe Jagger. It had been 3 hours since the Dark Horse had left the trading station. A rumor was spreading through the ship that they had run out of places to hide, which was fueled further when Granny Leatherhead summoned the crew to the dining area on the first deck.
Jake strapped himself into a seat next to Keller and Nanu. The captain stood on a table, clutching a star chart in one hand and rubbing her forehead with the other.
"Okay, folks, let's start with the good news," she said. "There's no sign of the ISS Magnificent on the long-range scanner. It looks as though we've made a clean getaway."
There was a ripple of half-hearted cheers from the crew. Jake knew that everyone was thinking the same thing.
"We would have been scuppered back there," said Fareed, "if it hadn't been for the divine wind."
"Yeah. Who were those Spacejackers?" asked Macca.
"I've already told you," croaked Granny Leatherhead. "I don't know."
"But you recognised the ship," said Calidus. Granny Leatherhead stiffened.
"I've not seen the divine wind for over a decade. As far as I knew, that old star frigate was sold for scrap when its captain died." "Has anyone heard of Wild Joe Jagger?"
Most of the crew shook their heads.
"I have," said Scargus. "His crew used to take on the most dangerous jobs that no one else would touch. He was responsible for the Ranco prison break and the Cordis gold heist."
"Aye, that's him," said Granny Leatherhead. "Wild Joe earned his reputation as one of the most daring and reckless spacejackers in the seven solar systems."
"How did he die?" asked Jake.
"Not well," said Scargus. "His body was found strapped to the hull of his ship. The crew were floating nearby, having been made to walk the airlock without spacesuits."
"Interstellar Navy do it?" asked Nanu.
"Unlikely," said Granny Leatherhead. "If they had caught a space pirate, they would have wanted the whole galaxy to know about it. Nah, I reckon he was killed by someone he knew. Wild Joe was quite a character, but not everyone liked his style. He had his share of enemies, the same as the rest of us."
"What are you saying?" asked Calidus. "We were rescued by a ghost?"
"Don't be ridiculous," she snapped. "The divine wind must have a new crew. At least they were prepared to fight. If it had been up to you, we would all be prisoners by now."
"If it had been up to you, we would all be dead by now."
"Please don't start that again," said Jake.
Fareed pointed to the star chart in her hand.
"Where are we heading, Captain?"
Granny Leatherhead looked down as though she had forgotten what she was holding.
"Ah, yes. Ah, that's the bad news. We need to find somewhere for Scargus and Manic to finish repairing the ship. It would also be nice to stay in the same place for a while."
"What about my dad?" asked Jake.
"What about him? We can't keep stumbling around the galaxy hoping to bump into your father. The crew needs some proper rest. You can use the time to come up with a plan to find him. He's been missing for 11 years, so a few more weeks or months won't harm."
"Where did you have in mind?" asked Nichelle.
"That's the problem. I've trawled the charts, but there aren't any safe ports nearby, and we've used up all our best hideouts. Does anyone have any ideas?"
It appeared that the rumour was true, and they had run out of places to hide.
"Papa Don's illegal spaceport," suggested Macca.
"Too far," said Granny Leatherhead. "Besides, I don't think the space mafia would be pleased to see us right now, not while we're the most wanted ship in the galaxy."
"How about the trading station?" stammered Warwick. "Admiral Vantar won't expect us to double back." "Nice idea. But for all we know, the ISS Magnificent might still be there."
"How about you, Calidus?" asked Fareed. "What did you learn from the naval gunship?"
"I found out that Admiral Vantard has warships searching for us in every solar system. There were also files about fleet deployments and gawks, but I was unable to access them."
"Fleet deployments?" said Nichelle. "That doesn't sound good."
"Who is gawks?" asked Nanu.
"Aliens."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.